My name is Beatriz Jaguaribe. I'm a professor at the School of Communications at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. The Federal University of Rio de Janeiro is a public university. That means that the students go there, it's absolutely free. It's the largest public university in Brazil. I've been a professor at that university for many decades and seen many interesting transformations over these decades. It's become a much more democratic school. It's become a university that has a wide range of students from many different backgrounds and many different classes. And it's part of a kind of an ongoing educational experience in the redemocratization process of Brazil. So it's been interesting and a thrill to work at the Federal University. My background is entirely literary. Although I teach at a school of communications, and my graduate studies were done in the United States at a time, it's even embarrassing to say how long ago, but very much at a moment when literature was dialoguing with cultural studies. So it was not so much a matter of reading texts, of studying literary theory, although we also did that, but of trying to engage narratives and literary texts with experiential phenomena of modernity at large. So this is something that captivated my imagination very much. And when I returned to Brazil after many years of the United States, I felt that entering into a school of communication would be an interesting opportunity because the strength of audiovisual culture was making itself so predominantly felt. And I thought that I had to engage in a dialogue with that. So that's basically my academic background. And the experiences that I had in the United States were as a graduate student, but also as a child, because after the military dictatorship of 1964, my family moved to the US for a number of years. So, but I returned to Brazil later on. I was honored to be part of the King Juan Carlos Center and to be awarded the Andrés Bello Chair in 2012. I had a lot of contact actually with NYU prior to having been given this wonderful opportunity that I really thoroughly enjoyed and learned so much from. And one of the reasons that I had so much contact with NYU is that my oldest sister, who's 10 years older than I am, she studied at NYU. So as an adolescent, I would visit her frequently in New York and had contact with professors and students at NYU. And then many dear friends that studied at graduate school with me eventually taught at NYU. The other very crucial encounter that I had with NYU was ICAS. ICAS was run by Professor Thomas Bender. It was centered on urban studies. It was a seminar. There was an array of very different students and professors who were engaged in themes of cultural urban history. And it was a tremendous experience for me. Professor Bender was a very generous mentor and really stimulated us into these very interesting and engaging discussions. And there was a real sense of experimentation. And we had many interesting workshops. And not only that, many interesting people came through, photographers, artists, some which became also very dear friends until this day. And I always was very inspired by the idea of this university with such a range of different students, but being very much enmeshed in the city, in the vibrant and variegated life of a big metropolis like New York. So that for me was one of the very inspiring facts of NYU. Not only the quality of the professors, the quality of the students, the material conditions, but because One felt that this intellectual and academic endeavor was also taking place against this very exciting metropolitan background, and that it was a kind of a response, and it led me to, I'm interested in urban culture. So it was like a live laboratory day after day to be part of this experience. While at Stanford, my advisor was Mary Louise Pratt, and she is the person that suggested my name, and I was extremely honored and very happy to accept. And also, of course, I had very close contact with the director of the center at that time, that was Joel Abani. We had a very warm, very engaged relationship with each other and with the center. And I would like to emphasize the wonderful partnership that I had with Laura Turegano. Both of them gave me a lot of not only encouragement, but really a lot of strength to carry forward whatever plans I had for the chairmanship. The international symposium that I organized at the King Juan Carlos Center was called Imagined Cities, Art, Cultural Politics, and the Invention of Urban Spaces in Latin America. One of the things that actually did happen is that we set up this seminar. We invited people from abroad. We invited photographers from Brazil. And then this Hurricane Sandy came around and shook everything up, because, you know, half of Manhattan was absolutely shrouded in darkness. So it was a little tense to know if this was actually going to be able to happen. I remember those buildings in NYU being completely blacked out, going down the stairs with flashlights and, you know, emergency situation. But actually, in the end, everything did work out. So this seminar was really about how artists connect to the city through literature, through photography. And we had panel discussions about that. And I thought it was a very engaging event, because it was a multi-disciplinary event, but more than anything else, it was an event that different people were able to really discuss the notion of the city as a kind of cultural arena. This notion of the cultural arena is something that has been derived from Richard Moores. He wrote an article about this, and the Argentine historian and specialist in cities, Adrián Gorelick, even made a book collection around this idea of cultural arenas that I was part of. And I think the seminar was a preliminary of that also, the idea of the city as a cultural arena and what kind of aesthetic inventions and actual lived experiences were taking place in different metropolitan scenarios of Latin America. So it gave spectators, I believe, a chance to see, to have a comparative vision. You know, one of the things that happens when you go to the United States for a person that comes from South America, which is actually quite interesting, is that when we are in our own countries, we become very locked up in the dynamics and in the dramas and the dilemmas of that country. So going to the United States, curiously, it gave me a chance to reconnect with Latin America, at least with an imaginary idea of Latin America. I didn't feel so bounded by the Brazilian circumstances. And then once again, I was able to connect with, you know, neighboring Argentines, Uruguayans, Mexicans, and et cetera, et cetera. So that idea was also very, it was something very, very interesting and very inspiring for me. The first public lecture was called Imagining the Marvelous City, and it was about the branding and the spectacularization of Rio de Janeiro. This was at a moment that Rio was being prepared for the Olympic events, and what I wanted to examine and critically analyze is what kind of branding efforts are made around urban culture, and how these branding efforts, they tap into urban repertoires and mythologies about the city. And in the end, what is this really going to do in terms of the lives and the living circumstances of the people who live in that city? So how these mega events become catalysts for putting the city in the arena of the global imaginary, but at the same time, what are the consequences of this, right? And a lot of the consequences of Brazilian or at the modernization of Rio have been very dire. Why do I say they're very dire? Because the modernizing impulse has largely catered to a selective class. And that means that a huge number of people are left out of this process. When one looks at the topography of Rio de Janeiro, it's very astonishing. And what one finds is a juxtaposition of shanty towns and high-rise and luxury buildings all coexisting side by side. And this is part of a deliberate process of modernization that does not follow, is not followed by an equal process of granting distribution of riches and citizenship. So I wanted to put all of these events under a critical agenda and question what was behind the spectacularization of the city. So this was one lecture. And the second public lecture was called Masses, Myths, and Media, Cultural Imaginaries in Brazil and Argentina. And basically, it was a comparison between the rituals, the public gatherings, the inventions of the nation. In the 1930s in Brazil, Getúlio Vargas rises to power, and in 37, he becomes actually a dictator whose government lasted until 1945. And what happened there was the establishment of the Brazilian state. He's a person that actually really fortified the Brazilian state. He invented, not he by himself, evidently, the group of intellectuals associated with him formed a kind of modernist inteligentsia that sought to define a Brazilian nationality. For the first time, there was a kind of an opening to the idea that modernity and the notion of hybridity, mestizo, all of that could be combined. Carmen Miranda, the famous lady with the tutti frutti hat, is exported as a kind of cultural icon to the United States. And what Vargas symbolizes at this moment is this conservative modernist invention, but at the same time, it's really an acting out of a huge populist politics. Not at the same time, but in the 50s, Perón rises in Argentina and kind of reinvents Argentine history and has a whole pact and alliance with the Argentine, what was then called the Argentine masses, the descamisados, etc. So in this public lecture, what I wanted to do is to compare how public photography reveals these political mechanisms, who are the protagonists of the nation at this moment, and what this imagery can bring to us in terms of memories of a future that were being projected at that time and that were only partially fulfilled. These public photographs are very powerful. There are photographs of rallies, there are photographs of manifestations, there are photographs of public buildings. They're all photographs in which there is a kind of a founding of the nation through the lens of this photographic process. While I was at the Andrés Bello Chair, aside from the public lectures, aside from the courses, I was also writing my book that eventually came out, published through Routledge, called Rio de Janeiro, Urban Life Through the Eyes of the City. At NYU, at the Spanish and Portuguese department, where also I had a very fruitful dialogue with professors and students, I gave a course. The course was called Masses, Myths, and Media. And basically, it was a course that was centered on the idea of urban imaginaries, but through three broad thematic issues. So what we were asking was, what I was concerned with at that time in my exchange with the students, was how cities were and are shaped imaginatively and materially, not only imaginatively, but materially by different media, because the presence of the media changes the relationships of urban space, the cognitive interactions, the experiential quality. The second aspect I was concerned at that moment was how configurations of the crowd, what was then called the masses in the vocabulary of the 1930s and 40s, and multitudes, how these were gleaned through modernist aesthetic and political agendas, and how they have become transformed through contemporary cultural practices, where you really don't have anymore this notion of masses, but through social media, you have these bubbles, you have these interactive communities. It's a very different notion. And finally, how urban mythologies were created in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, and how they became transformed through contemporary branding strategies of the entrepreneurial city. And New York, of course, is an evident example of that, but the course was actually focused in a selective and comparative analysis of different Latin American cities. Right now, I'm working on two very different projects. I think it's part of academia likes to have people that are specialized, and for some reason, I managed to survive in academia without being specialized at all, with kind of following what my passion and curiosity leads me to. The first project that I would like to comment a little bit with all of you is a cultural history of the map of Mato Grosso. Mato Grosso nowadays in Brazil is a state that has been divided between Mato Grosso and Mato Grosso do Sul. These are huge, enormous regions right at the dead center of the country. And Mato Grosso is also a very crucial state. Both of these states are very crucial because they are states that represent a huge amount of riches in regards to the soy and the agribusiness and cattle. And there are also states that had indigenous populations. And the Mato Grosso is a state that holds the indigenous reservation of the Xingu, the largest one in Brazil. Now, the making of the map of Mato Grosso has a very particular resonance for me, because the person who undertook this cartographical endeavor was my grandfather. He was part of the Rondon Commission. The Rondon Commission was an enterprise that has, rivers of ink have been written about it. Rondon was a man of indigenous descent. He was a military officer, an ardent positivist. And during decades, he penetrated into the hinterlands of Brazil and the states of Mato Grosso, Amazônia, Acre, and what is now Rondônia, named in his homage, and made contact with numerous indigenous tribes that had never been contacted before, and practiced what he called a pacification method. There's a lot of controversy, evidently, about what that entailed for the lives and the fate of these indigenous peoples. But what I was interested in is to do a cultural history of a map that begins to be charted in 1917 and is only finally published in 1952. So these people that were engaged in this map, my grandfather, Rondon, the explorers, the cartographers, the indigenous peoples that served as guides, this map went decades of Republican life. So if you look at the map as a palimpsest, you're not only cartographically seeing the exploration of an unknown hinterland, but you're also seeing the playing out of modernizing endeavors of the state and ideas of national construction. And there's also a personal aspect, because these two men, the main cartographer, who was Francisco Jaguaribe, and Rondon, they aged. The map took so long to be mapped out, to be charted. People died in these expeditions. People lost their lives. All kinds of misadventures happened, and their faces were beginning to become increasingly aged and creased as the rivers were being drawn and mapped out. So there's almost like a parallel to the making of the map and their own personal aging, and the construction of these Republican ideals of Brazil. And why is this so important? I think this is so important because nations, in order to exist, they obliterate so many peoples. They choose to forget, they erase, and they construct. But this effort of the map was also a map, an effort of institution building. And what we are now seeing in Brazil is the erasure of so many institutions under the Bolsonaro government. So this is like a kind of a critical effort of memories of the nation. I mean, modestly, I'm not, I don't want to make huge statements, but through the cultural history of the map, I think we can look at all these dilemmas and these contradictions of nation building. The second endeavor is an endeavor that I am undertaking with my colleagues from the Federal University of Rio, Consuelo Lins, Liv Sovic, and also from PUC, Andrea France and Patricia Machado, and also Professor Eduardo Kingman from Flaxo, Ecuador. And this is called the Open Archives of Latin American Cities. And what we are doing is that we're interpreting archives not only as patrimony, as buildings, as documents, as material evidence, but we're also interpreting, this is why we call it the open archives, we're interpreting archives as a kind of imagination, as ethnographical practices, and as political statements. So we're launching this site that gathers all these researchers from different institutions in Latin America, and this is becoming a really exciting experience for us. We want it to be a site that is not very strictly academic. We want to welcome activists. We want to welcome artists. The site has poetry, has narratives, has photography, and we very much want to emphasize this aspect of open. That's why we even invented a little seal that says open archives, because so many of us come from South American dictatorships where, we were used to reading documents with that rubber stamp saying censored. And this is our contribution to make it open and as democratic and as creatively engaging as possible.